Amen. Praise the Lord. We got disconnected. That's all right. I'm going to wait for my audience to build. It's amazing. Every time I decide that I'm going to speak something of this nature, I happen to always get disconnected. God bless you. Thank you for joining me again. Lena Johnson. I'm waiting for my audience to build. I'm going to go ahead and acknowledge these people as they're coming on. Waiting for my audience to build back. Then I'll get back into the topic. God bless you. Naomi, my great friend. I'll be calling you today. God bless you. Patrick. Pastor Patrick. Excuse me. I want to acknowledge you properly. God bless you. Great to see you. Just bear with me. I'm waiting for my audience to build because this is a very interesting topic. God bless you, Michelle Martin. I see all of you jumping back on. Yvette, God bless you. Veronica Hollingsworth, God bless you. Let me just wait for my audience to build. And I hope this is ministering to you. I hope this is ministering to you in one way or the other. And it is not my intentions to offend anyone, but to convict us into righteousness, into truth. God bless you, Lena Johnson. Thank you. God bless you, Roderick, man of God, Prophet Roderick. Great to see you, man of God. Thank you. Yes, the devil is mad. It's amazing. Every time I come on here, I'm talking about breaking strongholds or ideologies and the way we think about things. I always seem to get disconnected, and there's absolutely nothing wrong with my devices. We happen to always seem to get disconnected for a particular reason, not sure why, but that's okay. Jesus Christ is still Lord. We're back on here, and if I have to come back on, if it cuts back off, I'm going to jump right back on, so that's okay. God bless you, Pastor Lyndon, Apostle Drinker. Amen, amen, amen. All right, let me get back into this. All right, so let me say this. And so what began to happen, go ahead and invite some of your friends. So what began to happen, as I said, in retrospect, Sherry Lynn Johnson, God bless you. Great to see you in the house. And so what began to happen is that we criticize the church. We criticize the church, and we allow the church to suffer. We cause the church to suffer. Now, I said Moses, God asked Moses, what was that in your hand? And we're supposed to use our gifts, our talent. Even if you don't have the money financially to give into the church, give of what you have. Give what you have. And that's okay. That's okay. Right? Now, I'm gonna give you an example because, as I said to you before, a lot of people don't believe pastors deserve anything. And that is not fair. Because what happens is that the same people that criticize the pastors, that criticizes the church, are the same ones that come to you like Nicodemus by night, asking of your help, or asking and seeking assistance. They will come to you like Nicodemus by night. But these oftentimes are the same ones that's critiquing the church, criticizing the church, speaking all manner of evil against the church, and it is not fair. We need to apply wisdom. Listen. The Bible says that there was a woman that she only had two mites. And I'm not saying this as a cliche. There was a woman that had only two mites. God bless you, Chrissy Bonner. Had only two mites. The prophet of the Lord came to her and asked her of all that she had left. A little bit of oil, a little bit of flour. Now, a lot of us would have looked at that selfishly and said, well, guess what? I'm not giving the man of God nothing because this is all I have for me and my kid, and that's all I'm going to do. So they're not going to get anything. But this woman, she was so connected to what God was saying concerning the man's servant, so she gave out of nothing. I'm going to give you an example because I'm going to tell you something. On this, we're on the sixth day of fasting, but a lot of times, when we preach a message, God always puts us to the test. And I got my test on this week. Now, yes, I'm a minister. Yes, do I put PayPal me on Facebook? Yes, I do. At one given point, I did not want to do that at all. I said, God, I don't want nobody to lump me in with everybody else that is prostituting God's people. God, I don't want that kind of stigma. And God says, Listen, you are not responsible for how people react to you. You are not responsible for how they think. But what you want to get accomplished, you need partnership. You need help to make it be done. And so I said, Lord, I'm just going to be obedient to you. And thank God, I follow God and being obedient. Because of that, I am able to now begin to build into soul saving and helping the less fortunate. And I said, I thank God that I didn't listen to the critics or to the haters. People are going to think what they want to think. Now watch this. Now God put me to the test on this week. A lot of people say, well, don't give them your money. They need to go find a job. Do you know that most of the pastors you're telling to go find a job actually have a job? They just don't broadcast it. And I'm going to say this. A lot of people don't know. I don't share a lot about what I do in the secular world. But in the secular world, I'm actually a school teacher. People don't know that because I don't broadcast it. I don't feel the need to tell everybody and gloat in what I am and who I am. That's not important. Who I claim to be is not important. God is the one that's important. And I thank God he has given me the ability to do that. I happen to be a school teacher. A lot of people criticize, oh, she need to go find a job. I have a job. In fact, I have a career. I am a school teacher, right? And so, my money is my money. The church money is the church money. I have never, never misappropriated God's people's money. Not even 1 cent I touch because I work for my own. As well as, oh, I'm sure most of these pastors were criticizing work for their own. And guess what? Most of the money that I receive, I put it right into the vision that God has given. I put it right back into that. To help somebody else. And guess what? Guess what? A lot of times, and I'm going to be transparent in saying this, because I believe in keeping it real with people. People, if people know, teachers do not make the most money compared to other careers. They hardly pay us anything. But do I worry about that? I trust God to provide for me. Half of the times, especially living where I live in New York City, it's a strain. Sometimes having this kind of career that the government is not fair to teachers, but guess what? They don't pay us a lot, but I don't murmur about that. But pastors do have jobs. So for the people you're criticizing need to go find a job, they have jobs, right? And a lot of times there are people out there that's not spiritually prostituting you. So please don't judge everybody wrongfully. Use your discernment. Stop putting everybody in a group. What if we called you a spiritual prostitute? Would that be okay? What if some unbeliever out there said all church people are prostitutes, spiritual prostitutes, and all church people want is money? That would not be fair to you. You would not want someone to call you a spiritual prostitute. Why do you do it to other people? Unless the Holy Spirit has revealed that to you, then you have a right to say it because the Holy Spirit said it. But if you are saying it out of your own heart, you do not have a right to say anything. You don't have a right to put your mouth on a manservant or a woman servant, period. That is not your responsibility. God has not made you a judge over nobody. You are not sitting in the right hand of God unless the Holy Spirit has told you a particular thing about a particular person that is different from you saying things out of your own heart. Don't judge everybody. Thank you. I see Deborah saying that she's also a teacher. We hardly make anything. So watch this. And guess what? We oftentimes don't work during the summertime. So all that money that we worked throughout the years, I'm being honest with you. We have to save enough money to sustain ourselves before the school year starts. And guess what? Although I'm a preacher of the gospel, I had my challenge on this week. I'm saying, Lord, you know, this sometimes I'm praying for other people. They're seeing breakthrough. But God, sometimes it's a strain. It's a strain for us ministers because we deplete ourselves so much that we don't even have it ourselves. I'm being honest with you. Stay with me. And so what happens now, I got to test this on this week. A neighbor happened to come to me. I won't disclose his name. God bless him. Came to me on this week, knocked at my door. Excuse me, can I get some money? I just need some money. And I'm like, all right, Lord. I'm like this woman with the two mites that, Lord, what do you expect me to get this from? But whatever was in my wallet, I took it out of my wallet. See, this is the sacrifice that people don't see that you make. They're quick to criticize you, but they don't see the sacrifice and the plowing and the toiling and the laboring that you do. They just see the finished product and they look at your Facebook page and then, oh, she look like she got it all together. He look like he got it all together. I ain't giving nothing to them. They judge you based on your outward appearance, but they don't see the sacrifice you have to make. And so the person had asked, woman of God, I need some money. And I'm saying, whatever was in my pocket, I took it out. I didn't even save a penny for myself. I gave him all of it. Then he turned around and says, I am so hungry. I am so hungry. I was like the woman with the mic this week. I had that experience. And he says, woman of God, I'm so hungry. Can you find anything? I went into my fridge. I took out all my poultry. I took out some of my canned foods and I gave it to him. And I'm saying, well, Lord, you're going to have to provide for me. But I said, okay, God, I'm not going to worry about it because somebody is in need. The man came back and said, you know what? I'm so sorry. I can't cook this food. I have nowhere to cook it because I gave him raw foods, canned goods. And I said, you know what? I'll cook the food for you. And I made pans of food for him. And I'm not saying that to look recognition. I'm giving you an example. I cooked pans of food for him and I gave it to him. And I said, Lord, be glorified in that. That's what it's about. We sometimes have to give of ourselves to sow into somebody else's life so that they can say, wow, to God be the glory. Surely God is God. So if we don't sacrifice ourselves to sow into somebody else, how will they get blessed? How will God get glorified? But people automatically look at us and judge us and say, well, they have it all together. I'm not going to give into their ministry or into their life. That's not fair. Everybody is not a spiritual prostitute. You need spiritual discernment before you go around saying all pastors are prostitutes and all they want is your money and all they is greedy. That's not fair. Don't muzzle the ox, because we're the same ones you come to and ask for prayer. We got to get up all wee hours of the night and get up to pray for you. We have to be on our face every single day praying for you, even when we're suffering and nobody sees that we're leaving.